Hello. Today we're talking about something super cool in game development called wave function collapse. I'm sure you've never heard of it anywhere but here. So this video is essentially going to be in two parts. The first part's quite brief, and I'm just going to explain what wave function collapse is. And then in the second part, I'm going to take you through the code that I created to make this video. So imagine you have a bunch of Lego pieces, each with different colors and shapes, and you want to build a big picture using these pieces. In game development, wave function collapse is like a Lego game. Developers have a bunch of tiles or pieces for their game world, like grass or water or roads. The wave function collapse algorithm helps put these tiles together in a way that makes sense, like making sure that water tiles connect to form a river, or grass tiles connect to form a meadow. It's like a smart puzzle solver that helps create awesome, believable worlds without having to place each tile by hand. So how does that work? The basic premise is exactly the same regardless of what your world looks like, whether it's like a 3D generated world or a 2D map or anything like that, or even just like a straight platformer side-scrolling thing. And what it does is you have a wave, quote wave, which is, say, in the case of the animation that you're watching right now, a tile, a 2D tile on a top-down kind of world thing. We collapse one tile down from all the potential tiles it could be to the tile that it actually is, like this is potentially just picking at random. In fact, that is how we do it in this video. We just pick one at random from the potential tiles. As soon as we do that, all the neighboring tiles are changed. Their potential tiles are reduced based on that neighboring tile, because only certain tiles will go next to other tiles. So once we have a potential tile collapse down to a proper tile, then we can't put certain tiles in the neighboring slots anymore. Then we move on to the neighbors, we collapse down to one of the potential tiles, and that again reduces the number of tiles that the neighboring tiles can have, and we continue, and that means that the world is created in a logical fashion that all makes sense, like roads connect to each other, beaches border water, and so on. This is a form of procedural generation, which it has its advantages, has a lot of advantages over just essentially randomly generating the world. For one thing, the world makes more logical, consistent sense as opposed to just generating the world randomly. It makes it easier to have the world arranged in a way that fits your vision for what that world should look like, even though you're generating the world procedurally. And by specifying different rule sets, you can have the world come together in different ways. For example, here I've got dirt and road, and because they're set not to interact with each other, they never touch each other, which causes a few glitches because I haven't spent that long setting it up. But with a few tweaks and adding a special tile for joining dirt, road, and road together, we get this. So, with the explanation out of the way, now let's go through the actual code I used to do the video part that you're watching in the background while I've been talking. So bear in mind that this is the way I did it for this video. I was just trying to get things working. This isn't necessarily how I would recommend you do it in a production environment if you were actually making a game. So we start off in our scripts folder, and we're going to create a script called WFC node. So for the purposes of my video, this is a scriptable class, and the reason for that is we need to be able to actually add in the nodes, and this is the simplest way of doing it. I strongly recommend you don't do it this way when you're doing it for real, because, well, for lack of a better term, it is a massive ball ache. And it needs to be system.serializable. And then all we're gonna have in here is a public string, which is gonna be our name, which is fairly self-explanatory. A public game object, which is gonna be the prefab that we actually spawn in the world. Now, if you were, for example, using Unity tile map system or some other system in like maybe Godot or something like that, this would obviously need changing to suit your system. Now, before we create the rest of them, we're gonna need a second class, which is also gonna be system.serializable. Public class, which we're just gonna call WFC connection. All the connection is going to be is information regarding a direction from that node. So the top, in our case, because we're doing a tile system, the top, the left, the right, and the bottom. So this is going to be a public list, and it's going to be WFC nodes, sorry, node, and we're just going to call it compatible nodes. And then in here, we want a direction for each, we want a connection for each direction. Yeah, that rhymes. So public WFC connection, and the first one's going to be top, and then obviously the rest of them are bottom, left, and right. Now, if you're doing this for a different system, say you were doing a 2D platformer and you only had left and right to worry about, you'd only need left and right. If you were doing a 3D system, the system would essentially work the same way. You just need to accommodate all the extra directions in which your node can have a neighbor. Because this is a 2D map and it's not like a hexagon or anything like that, we only need to worry about those four directions. So now we've got that, that's this script done now. We don't need to touch this again. And you can see if we create, we can go to WFC, we can go to node, and we can create a node. And then over here, we have, we can give it a name, we give it a prefab, and then in our compatible nodes list, all we would be doing is dragging in other compatible nodes. So these are all the nodes that can go above this one. These are all the nodes that can go below it, to the left, to the right, you get the point. The one thing I will point out, and the reason why this system, which obviously I cobbled together for this video, is such a pain in the neck, is because you don't just do it here. Like, say I drag another node into this slot here, to the top slot of this node, I then have to go to that node and put this node in the bottom slot of that node. So it has to be in both, if you get what I mean. Otherwise the algorithm will not see it as a valid connection. Anyway, let's just delete that for now and we'll move on to our next script. So we're going to create a new script, and this one we're just going to call WFC Builder. But this is the main script. This is where the algorithm goes. So to start with, we need a public int for our width and a public int for our height. And strictly speaking, good practice wise, this should really be serialize field private int, because there's no reason for it to be public. So let's just change that. But again, I cobbled this together for the video, so it wasn't exactly best practice all through. Then we need a private WFC node 2D array. And this is going to be called our grid. And this is going to store references to all of the nodes that we collapse, all of the cells that we actually collapse, so that we can reference them later. Because obviously, if we just spawn something into the world, it's going to be a pain in the neck to then check that what we've spawned when we do the cell next to it. So this allows us to easily check what the cell is in a given position. Then we need a public list, and this is going to be another node list, but this one is called nodes. And this list is just going to contain all of the possible nodes that we have to spawn into the world. And then we need one more list, and this one is private, doesn't need to be accessed anywhere but in this script. And this one is a list of vector2 ints. Now again, this would be different if you were doing something other than a 2D system. Because I'm doing 2D system, I only need to accommodate up, down, left, right. I only need a 2D coordinate system. If you were doing a 3D wave collapse function, this would have to be, you know, vector3 int, or even vector, like you might even have to come up with a completely different system, maybe a dictionary, for example. The reason I can get away with a vector2 int is because I'm using a grid and I'm sticking to one, like each of my cells is going to be one by one. So my world position directly corresponds to the grid position. And we're just going to call this one 2Collapse. It's going to equal a new list of vector2 ints. And all this is going to be is we are going to loop through this list until it is empty. And what we're going to do is this list is going to contain all the nodes we know that need collapsing. So we start off with one node that we're going to put in there manually. That's just going to be in the middle of the grid. And then we're going to check each of its neighbors. If we encounter a neighbor that has not yet been collapsed, we add it to this list. If it has been collapsed, great, we don't need to do anything with it. So what we do then is we loop through the list. Each time we encounter an uncollapsed neighbor, we add it to the list and we just keep going until there are no more neighbors left to collapse. So that's what this list is for. And then we need a, well, we don't need, but this just makes life a little bit easier, a vector2 int called offsets. That's going to equal a new vector2 int, and we're going to manually assign this new vector2 int, and it's going to be not one, and then we'll just copy that. And then these are the neighbor coordinates, or the neighbor, well, the offset of the neighbor from the current cell. So obviously this one is top, this one is bottom, this one is right, and this one is left. And that just means that when we're checking the neighbors, we can just loop through this array and check the offsets rather than having duplicate code essentially to check each one. Right, so that's enough of our declarations. Now we can get into our start function. And the first thing we're going to do is initialize our grid. So grid is going to equal new WFC node width and height, and it's that simple. And then we're going to call the function that we haven't written yet called collapse world. So let's first off just create that function to get rid of that error. But before we get to that function, there's two other functions that we need to write that we're going to be using in collapse world. So the first of them, fairly straightforward, is a private bool called is inside grid. That's going to take in a vector2 int, which we'll just call v2int, and that's going to say if v2int.x is greater than minus 1 and v2int.x is less than width and v2int.y is greater than minus 1 and v2int.a is less than height. If all of those things are true, return true, else return false. It should be fairly obvious what's happening here, but basically we're just making sure that whatever this vector 2 is, the two coordinates stored in that vector 2 int are within the grid boundaries, are within this boundary here, which is set by these values here. And what that does is it means that we can run that check and we can be sure that whatever we're checking isn't going to give us an out of bounds error. Now the next function we're going to need, called private void, and we're going to call this whittle nodes. And it's going to take in a list, WFC nodes, and this is going to be called potential nodes. Now, the way C# works with these lists is because we're passing in this list here, it's a reference rather than a copy. So if we modify this list in this function, which we will be doing, it actually modifies the list that we've passed. It doesn't make a new list and then modify that list. So that's how we're going to use this function. And then the other thing we take in is a list of WFC node, and this one's just going to be called valid nodes. So all this list is going, all this function is going to do is it's going to compare these two lists that we pass in. This is the list of nodes that are allowed, and this is the list of nodes that we currently have. If we encounter a node in this list that is not in this list, we remove it from this list. So we need to do a loop through this list to start with, the potential nodes list. So for int, and we're going to do this a bit different to normal, I equals potential nodes dot count minus 1. And the reason we're starting at the end of the list rather than beginning is because we're going to be removing items from the list. Now, if we start at the top and start removing items, we're going to end up skipping over items because we'll be on, say, for example, item number 2. Let's try and visualize this a little bit. So we have a list 1, 2, 3, 4, or 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So we start at 0, that's fine, we leave it there. We check 1, that's fine, we leave it there. We check 2, and that's not fine, and we remove it. Now 3 moves up a place, but we're still at the same index. So that means we go to the next index, which is now what was 4. I hope that makes sense. So to get around that, we start at the end of the list and we work backwards. So if we encounter one that we want to remove, we're at the other end of the list and then we're moving upwards. It doesn't affect the order. So then I is greater than minus 1, has to be minus 1 because obviously we want to factor in 0. And then I minus minus rather than plus plus, which is how we usually do for loops. So for each of these, if not valid nodes dot contains potential nodes I. So if the list of valid nodes does not contain the node that we are currently looking at, we want to take it away, we want to get rid of it, dot remove at I. So by the end of this loop, potential nodes will only contain nodes that are also in this list. So you'll see how we use that function very shortly. Those are the two functions we need. Now we can get onto our actual main algorithm. So to start with, just as a little check, we're going to make sure our to collapse list is clear. We don't want, if say you use this function multiple times in the same game, you don't want to accidentally have leftover nodes from the previous one. It should be clear anyway, because we're supposed to be looping through this list until it's empty, but I'm paranoid. So the next thing we do is we add our first node. So this is just going to be new vector int, and it's going to be width divided by 2, height divided by 2. So it wouldn't be exactly in the middle if you have an even number, but it's close enough. Like, it doesn't necessarily matter wherever you put this. You could put it in the top corner, you could put it, and you could just completely pick a random value. Wherever you put it, it should eventually populate the whole map. I'm just putting it in the middle for the sake of visuals, because as you saw in the previous part of the video, I had that thing where it expanded outwards and showed you the actual process, and that looks better if you start in the middle. So now for the loop part. So we're going to say while to collapse dot count is greater than 0. So as long as there is something in the collapse list, the to collapse list, we keep going. So the first thing we do in here is just to make life a little bit easier, because we're going to be referencing the item that we are currently on, is we're going to say int x equals to collapse 0.x. And then we're just going to copy that, but this time for y. And the reason we can reference 0 is because we are always looking at the first item in the list. So this is kind of the reverse of what I was doing here. Here, we checked the end of the list first so that if we remove something, it doesn't affect the order. Here,
we're basically doing the opposite. We're always looking at the first item in the list, and then we're removing that item. And then everything shuffles up one place, and then we look at the first item in the list, and then we remove that item, and everything shuffles up, and we repeat until there's nothing left. So we're just going to put X and Y into these handy little ints here, because it's going to be easier to type. So before we get into the actual whittling down, we need a list, and that list is going to be WFC node, and we're going to call this potential nodes. And it's going to equal a new list of WFC nodes, but we're going to pass in the nodes array. So what that does is it copies this array here, which we will set in the inspector, into this array. So this is So this is a new list, but it has all the same contents of this list. Now, that list, if you remember, contains all of the nodes that we have to spawn into our world, all the possible nodes that we can have. So essentially, we start off from a position of any node that we have can be spawned. And then we need to eliminate nodes depending on the circumstances. So next up, we need to loop through all of our neighbors. So this is why we created this array here, just to make this part a little bit easier. Int I equals naught. I is less than offsets.length, I++. Helps if you spell length correctly. And then just as we did here, we're going to store our current neighbor in a handy little vector2 int, so we don't have to keep referencing the actual array. Vector2 int neighbor equals new vector2 int x plus offsets I dot x, and then same for the y. And that's just getting the current neighbor and storing in here. So now instead of doing this every time, we can just call this. So the first thing we want to do for each of the neighbors is check, is it inside the grid? Is inside grid neighbor. So the reason we do this is to make sure that we're not trying to check something that is outside of the bounds of this array, because if that's the case, we're going to get a null out of bounds error. What you do here is entirely up to you. I've chosen to leave it so that it treats it as there could be anything off the edge of that grid. You could make it so that it always has to have a particular tile at the edge. Maybe like the edge of your world is all mountains, so if you encounter the edge of the world, you put mountains there. What you do in here is entirely up to you. So once again, we're just going to cache the neighbor node just to make life a little bit easier. So obviously we're only doing this if we are within the bounds of the grid, so we can safely just grab something from the grid. Obviously that should be node, not builder. Thank you, autofill. Now, once we've got that, we need to make sure that it's not null. So that's a simple check, if neighbor node does not equal null. And the reason for that is because we need to check what valid nodes this neighbor contains. And obviously if that neighbor doesn't exist, then we can't do that. Null means that we haven't collapsed this grid position yet. So we'll get to what we're going to do with if it does exist. If it doesn't exist, we're just going to come down here to the else, and we're going to say if to collapse does not contain neighbor, then add neighbor, collapse.add neighbor. And the reason we do this check first to make sure the list doesn't already contain it is because it is possible for two nodes to have the same neighbor. It sounds counterintuitive because we're using a grid system with four directions, but like when you start, because we're not adding nodes to the list in like a uniform order, we're adding them as we encounter them, it is possible to get two nodes added to the list, or even three nodes in some cases added to the list at the same time. And then that means that we try and collapse that same node over and over again. So we need to make sure the list doesn't contain it before we add it. But then if it doesn't contain it, we add it to the list, and then next time around, when we come back up here, that one will get added and go through all this process. However, if neighbor does not equal null, that means the neighbor's already been collapsed and we have a tile there. So we can use that tile to decide what tile this one can be. So to do that, switch I, and again, it's not the cleanest of code, but this is more about showing you the process than giving you the best code to work with. So we're calling our whittle nodes function. We're passing in the potential nodes list. So if you remember, potential nodes to start with contains all of the nodes that we can possibly have in this level. As we cycle through this loop here, that list will get shorter and shorter. So potential nodes is the list that we're passing in. And then the valid nodes comes from neighbor node dot and then the direction. So if we look up here, our first one, our first offset is top. That means that the ones that we need to check against are the bottom, because the top of one, that needs to be compatible nodes. That's what we called it. So I'm getting this error here because I've just realized I made a bit of a mistake here. This temp, ignore that. That is from my code that I was making to start with. There we go. So the code I did when I was feeling out the project and working out how I was going to do it is still in the project, which is why it was confused by that temp. It was trying to autofill. So we pass in our potential nodes, and then we pass in the opposite. So the opposite connection point to the one we're currently looking at. So currently we are looking, if we assume that this is zero, we are looking at the top position, which means we need to check the neighbor's bottom position to see which ones are compatible. And then we just basically duplicate this for each of our offsets. So we say we've got bottom, right, and left. So this wants to be top, left, and right. So when we're looking at the top one, we're checking the neighbor's bottom one. When we're looking at the bottom one, we check the neighbor's top. When we're looking at the right connection, we check the neighbor's left. And when we're looking at the left connection, we check the neighbor's right. Fairly straightforward. So now that we've looped through all of our neighbors, this potential nodes list will now contain only nodes that all four of the neighbors allow. If the neighbor is out of the grid, in my case, I ignore it. So I just treat it as anything could be there. If the neighbor has not yet been created, we've added it to the list to do later. And again, we can assume it can be anything. And then that becomes a problem for that neighbor, which has to factor in this neighbor. So the first thing we do is if potential nodes.count is less than one. So this is just a little check, which basically says we haven't got anything. That means that the potential nodes list has been whittled down to zero and there are no potential nodes that will fit this position. In the event that this happens, you can either create more tiles that would suit this particular situation. You can keep iterating through and finding out which ones throw up this error, and then you can create more tiles that fit. Or you could actually have the algorithm go back and look at the neighbors. So you could add the neighbor back to the two collapse list and then have that one regenerate, factoring in this one. And you could keep doing that until you find a combination of the tiles that actually works. In my case, I've chosen to just put the blank tile, which will be the first tile. So the first tile I put in the array will be the blank tile, the just plain grass in my case, but like a kind of a catch-all tile. And that's going to be in the first position in the list, so I'm just going to put that there. And then also, I'm just going to drop a little debug dot log warning, attempted to collapse wave on plus X plus Y, but found no compatible nodes. And then that just shows me that we've encountered this error, so I can tell if... Because this is such a picky little process, this means that I can easily tell if one thing that doesn't look right is because I've done something wrong or because we're missing a tile that works in that space. And then else, our list has more than one option. We simply say grid XY equals potential nodes, and then we're just going to get random.range not to potential nodes.count. So we're just picking a random node out of the potential nodes list. Now, you could get fancy with this. You could give, for example, you could give nodes weight. So you could say this node is more likely to appear than this node, and you could factor that in. I'm just picking one at random. And then once we've done that, we want to actually spawn the object into the world. So again, if you were using a 2D tile map, for example, then you would need to swap this out for code that edits the tile map. If you were using some completely different system, like I said, if it was a 3D world and you were editing a mesh, you'd need to change your code to suit that. I'm literally just instantiating a tile into the world. So all I need to do is object new node equals instantiate. And then we're getting grid XY, which we've just populated up here. We've put a node in the grid at that position, so we know there's one there. At new vector 3 X, Y, and 0, because it's a 2D grid, so we're just putting it at Z0. If you were doing a flat grid, you would be 0 and Y here. This is a vertical grid because it's 2D. And then just quaternion.identity, because obviously we're not rotating it. We have to call the prefab. We're not just instantiating the node, we're instantiating the prefab stored within that node. And then finally, to collapse dot remove at 0. So we take this node that we've just collapsed out of the list, and then we move on to whatever is left in the list, and we repeat that process until there are no more neighbors left to collapse. Now, if I head back into Unity, you can see that I have already populated these nodes, because as I mentioned, it is a hell of a hassle to do it this way. But say, for example, here we have the bottom left corner. If you remember from the animation I showed you at the start, in fact, I'll just pull that animation back up again. So all the nodes that are compatible with the top of the bottom left corner tile. And then if we look, so let's just pick one at random here. We have here vertical left T junction. So if we go to vertical left, and that's in the top there. So in the top, vertical left T junction, if we go to vertical left T junction and we check the bottom, we can say bottom left corner. was there. And you have to do that on both. So it has to appear in both, otherwise it'll get eliminated from the potential nodes list. So obviously, if you were doing this properly and you were making a real world, you would want to come up with a better system than this. Like, at the very least, you would want to write code that automatically adds. So if I drag top left corner into here, it automatically adds this node to that one's top edge connection. At the very least, probably you would want to come up with some kind of drag and drop system to make it even easier.
And one of the benefits about the way I've set up this system is that we're using prefabs, so you can swap out those prefabs for anything. Like here, I'm demonstrating the exact same code, like no changes to anything, except for I've swapped out the sprites that I made, these little pixel art sprites, for some assets from Kenny. And if you don't know who Kenny is, link in the description, always check him out if you're a game dev. And that creates the same thing, but with 3D tiles. And that concludes this video on wave function collapse. So, as always, I'd like to give a special thanks to all the supporters, whether you're supporting by liking, sharing, watching the video, and leaving comments. All of these things help the channel, but also the people who actually contribute financially to the channel, and those are the people on Patreon, the people who give Nitro to the Discord and all that kind of thing. Massive thanks to you guys, and as always, a special thanks to the Sugar Daddy / Mommy tier supporters, who are Dave Maldine, Reg Reed, Gabriel White, Aaron Clark, and Inanye. That's all for now, and I'll hopefully see you next time.
Bye-bye.